Lullaby course number 23, A Course in Miracles, original edition, chapter 8, section 10, The Acceptance of Reality. Fear of the will of God is one of the strangest beliefs that the human mind has ever made. This strange belief could not possibly have occurred unless the mind were already profoundly split, making it possible for the mind to be afraid of what it really is. It is apparent that reality cannot threaten anything except illusions, since reality can only uphold truth. The very fact that the will of God, which is what you are, is perceived as fearful to you, demonstrates that you are afraid of what you are. It is not then the will of God which you are afraid, but your will, what you are. Your will is not the ego's, and that is why the ego is against you. Your will is not the ego's will, and that is why the ego is against you. What seems to be the fear of God is really only the fear of your own reality. It's impossible to learn anything consistently in a state of panic. And if the purpose of this course is to help you learn what you are, and if you've already decided that what you are is something you should be afraid to see, then it must follow that you will not learn this course. If the purpose of this course is to help you learn what you are, but you've already decided that what you are is something you should be afraid of, then it must follow that you won't learn this course. Yet you might remember that the reason for this course is that you do not know who you are or what you are. And if you don't know what and who you are, then how would you know whether what you are is fearful or not? The association of truth and fear, like if it's the truth, it's something I should fear. The association of truth and fear, which would be highly artificial at most, is particularly inappropriate in the minds of those who do not know what truth is. Associating truth with fear by those who don't really know what truth is, that's particularly inappropriate. All that this kind of association between truth and fear means is that you are arbitrarily endowing something quite beyond your awareness, what you are, with something you don't want, fear. It is evident then that you are judging something of which you are totally unaware. And you have set this strange situation up so that it's completely impossible to escape from this situation without a guide who does know what and who you are. And the purpose of this guide is merely to remind you of what you want. Let me remind you of what you want because of what you are. This guide is not attempting to force an alien will upon you. This guide is merely making every possible effort within the limits you impose on it to reestablish your own will in your consciousness. What you really want. What you don't really want is fear. And you've associated that with your truth, so now you're afraid of your truth. You're afraid to find your truth. And this guide is merely making every possible effort within the limits you impose on it to reestablish what you really want, in your awareness, in your consciousness. I know what I don't want. I know what the ego doesn't want. to hear my truth because it's made it fearful. But what is it that I do want? This guide's purpose is to remind us of what I do want instead of fear. You have imprisoned what you want in your unconscious. You have imprisoned your will in your unconscious, where your will, what you really want, remains available but can't help you. When we said that the higher mind's function is to sort out the true from the false in your unconscious, we meant that the higher mind has the power to look into what you have hidden and see the will of God there, what God wants, what you want there. The higher mind's perception of God's will there in your mind can make God's will real to you because the higher mind is in your mind, and therefore the higher mind is your reality. If then the higher mind's perception of your mind brings your mind's reality to you, then this higher mind is teaching you what you are and reminding you that you want it, that it's not fearful, it's beautiful, it's what you really want. The only source of fear in this whole process can only be what you think you lose. Yet it is only what your higher mind sees that you can possibly have. I'm afraid of this process of seeing my truth because I believe that I could lose. But it's only what my higher mind sees that I can possibly have. So there is no loss in only going with the higher mind guidance about what it is I want. We have emphasized many times that the Holy Spirit will never call upon you to sacrifice anything. The Holy Spirit will never call upon you to sacrifice anything. But if you ask the sacrifice of reality of yourself, if you ask for sacrifice for yourself, then the higher mind must remind you that sacrificing is not what God wants for you, because that's not what you want. You don't want to give up something to lose. There is no difference between your will and God's. And if you didn't have split minds, you would recognize that that is freedom, because that is communication. It's impossible to communicate in alien tongues. And so, you and your Creator can communicate through creation, because that and only that is your joint will. You and your Creator, it's impossible for you to communicate in alien tongues, and so you and your Creator can communicate through creation. You and your creator can communicate through creation, because that is God's will and also yours. That and only that is your joint will, the thing you and God both want. Divided wills do not communicate. Divided wills do not communicate because they speak for different things to the same mind. Split wills speak for different things to the same mind, which makes you lose the ability to communicate. Split mind loses the ability to communicate simply because confused communication from a split mind doesn't mean anything. A message cannot be said to be communicated unless that message makes sense. And how sensible can your messages be when you ask for what you do not want? Yet as long as you are afraid of your will, your truth, your reality, then what you don't want is precisely what you will ask for. You may insist that the Holy Spirit does not answer you, but it might be wiser to consider the kind of asker you are. What kind of asker are you? Well, first of all, you don't ask only for what you want. That's what kind of asker you are. You don't ask only for what you want. And that you don't ask only for what you want is solely because you are afraid you might receive it, and you would. That is really why you persist in asking the teacher who could not possibly teach you your will. Of the teacher who cannot possibly teach you what you want, you can never learn what you want, and not learning what you want from this teacher who can't teach it to you, this gives you the illusion of safety. Now I'm safe from truth. Yet you cannot be safe from truth. You can only be safe in truth. Reality is the only safety. Reality is the only safety. Reality is the only safety. What you want is your freedom, because what you want is the same as what God wants for you and for himself. The separation is nothing more than the belief that what you want for yourself and what God wants for you is different. No mind can believe that what it wants is stronger than what God wants. If then a mind believes that what it wants is different from what God wants, then that mind can only decide either that there is no God or that God's will is fearful. The mind that has decided that there is no God accounts for the atheist, and the latter for the martyr. Martyrdom takes many forms. The category of martyrdom includes all doctrines which hold that God demands sacrifices of any kind. Martyrdom takes many forms. The category including all doctrines which hold that God demands sacrifice of any kind. Either basic type of insane decision, either that God's will is fearful or there is no God, either basic type of insane decision will induce panic. It will induce panic because the atheist believes he's alone, and the martyr believes that God is crucifying him. Both the atheist and the martyr both really fear abandonment and retaliation. But the atheist is more reactive against abandonment, and the martyr against retaliation. The atheist is more reactive against abandonment, and the martyr is more reactive against retaliation. The martyr responds to retaliation. The atheist is reactive against abandonment. The atheist maintains that God has left him, but that God doesn't care. The atheist maintains that God has left him, but that he doesn't care that God has left him. The atheist will, however, become very fearful and hence very angry if anyone suggests that God has not left him. The martyr, on the other hand, is more aware of guilt, and believing that punishment is inevitable, the martyr attempts to teach himself to like the punishment. The truth is, very simply, that no one wants either abandonment or retaliation. But many, many people seek both. No one really wants either abandonment or retaliation, but many people seek both. But it's still true that those people who seek it don't want them, really. And can you ask the higher mind for gifts such as abandonment or retaliation, and actually expect to receive abandonment and retaliation from the higher mind? The higher mind cannot make you want something you don't want. The higher mind cannot make you want something you don't want. When you ask the universal giver for what you do not want, you are asking for what cannot be given because it was never created. It was never created because it was never your will. Your will for you is not what you wanted. It wasn't your will for you. It wasn't what you wanted. To suffer and to sacrifice. It was never what you wanted. It was just what you thought was true. Ultimately, everyone must remember the will of God, because ultimately everyone must recognize themselves. This recognition of yourself is the recognition that your will and God's will are one. In the presence of truth, there are no unbelievers, no atheists, and no martyrs. In the presence of truth. In the presence of truth, there are no atheists and no martyrs. In the security of reality, fear is totally meaningless. To deny what is can only seem to be fearful. Fear cannot be real without a cause, and God is the only cause. God is love. And you do want God. God is love, and you do want God. This is your will. This is what you want. God is love, and you do want God. You do want love. God as love, God's love is your will. That's what you really want, that you've denied. Well, if you'll ask only for this, God's will, God's love, and you will be answered, because you will be asking only for what belongs to you. When you ask the Holy Spirit for what would hurt you, sacrifice or abandonment or retaliation, then the Holy Spirit cannot answer you, because nothing can hurt you, and so you are asking for nothing. Any desire which stems from the ego is a desire for nothing, and to ask for anything of the ego is not a request, but a denial in the form of a request. Any desire which stems from the ego is a desire for nothing. And so to ask for anything of the ego is not a request. It is merely a denial in the form of a request. To ask for nothing is not a request. It's a denial in the form of a request. The higher mind is not concerned with form at all, because the higher mind is only aware of meaning. The ego cannot ask the higher mind for anything, because there is complete communication failure between the ego and the higher mind. But you can ask for everything of the higher mind, because your requests are real, being of your will. When you're asking for what you really will, now your request is real. ask for everything of the higher mind, because your requests of the higher mind are real, being of your will. Would the higher mind deny the will of God, the love of God? Could the higher mind fail to recognize the love of God in God's creations? The energy which you withdraw from creation, you expend on fear. The energy which you withdraw from creation, you expend on fear. This is not because your energy is limited, but because you have limited your energy. You do not recognize the enormous waste of energy which you expend in denying truth. What would you say of somebody who persisted in attempting the impossible, believing that to achieve it is success? You would say you're wasting your energy. The belief that you must have the impossible in order to be happy is totally at variance with the principle of creation and the ultimate waste of energy. God could not will that your happiness depended on what you could never have, and so wasting your energy. God could not will, would never will, that your happiness depend on what you could never have, and so thereby wasting your energy. The fact that God is love does not require belief. But the fact that God is love does require acceptance. It is indeed possible for you to deny facts, although it is impossible for you to change facts. If you hold your hands over your eyes, you will not see, because you are interfering with the laws of seeing. Same as saying, if you deny love, you will not know love, because your cooperation is the law of love's being. And so if you deny love, you won't know love, because your cooperation is the law of love's being. You cannot change laws you did not make. And the laws of happiness were created for you, not by you. Attempts of any kind to deny what is fearful. And if those attempts to deny what is strong, then those attempts will induce panic. Attempts of any kind to deny what is fearful. And if your attempts to deny what is are strong, then those attempts will induce panic. Trying to will against what is, though impossible, can be made into a very persistent goal, even though you do not want it. But consider the result of this strange decision to try to accomplish the impossible and invest all your energy and expend all your energy in this strange decision to try to make true what's not, to deny reality. The result of this strange decision to do that is that you are devoting your mind to what you do not want. You are devoting your mind to what you do not want. You are devoting your mind to what you do not want. Is the result of the strange decision of resisting, denying what is, which is truth, which is love, which is God, is love. If you don't really want it, then it was really never created. If it was never created, it is nothing. Can you really devote yourself to nothing? Thank you. in his devotion to you, created you devoted to everything, and then gave you what you were devoted to. Otherwise, you would not have been created perfect. Reality is everything, and therefore you have everything because you are real. Reality is everything, and therefore you have everything because you are real, because you have reality. If reality is everything, then you have everything because you are real. You cannot make the unreal, because the absence of reality is fearful, and fear cannot be created. As long as you believe that fear is possible, you will not create. Opposing orders of reality make reality meaningless, and reality is meaning. So there must not be opposing orders of reality. And you cannot oppose reality. But trying to oppose reality induces panic. Devoting your mind to what you do not want will induce panic. Trying to accomplish the impossible will induce panic. Although impossible. You have been devoting your mind to what you do not want, and so your devotion has not been real. You never really wanted it. But God, in his devotion to you, created you devoted to everything and then gave you what you are devoted to. Otherwise, you could not have been created perfect. Reality is everything, and therefore you have everything because you are real. You cannot make the unreal, because the absence of reality is fearful, and fear cannot be created. And so as long as you believe that fear is possible, you will not create. Opposing orders of reality make reality meaningless, and reality is meaning. Remember then that what God wants for you, God's will, is already possible, and nothing else will ever be possible than what God wants for you, which is what you really want, which is something that never asks for sacrifice and never abandons or retaliates. This is the simple acceptance of reality, because only this is real. You cannot distort reality and know what reality is. And if you do distort reality by trying to deny reality, then you will experience anxiety, and then you will experience depression, and then you will ultimately experience panic, because you're trying to make yourself unreal by distorting reality, by denying reality. Reality that God is love, and so everything is love, and so you are only love. Trying to deny that and oppose that will bring about anxiety, depression, and ultimately panic, because you're trying to make yourself unreal. When you feel these things, when you experience anxiety, depression, and panic, do not try to look beyond yourself for truth. Do not try to look beyond yourself for truth. For truth can only be within you. Truth can only be within you. Say therefore. Christ is in me, and where Christ is, God must be. When you feel these things, when you feel anxious, when you feel depression, when you feel panic, do not try to look beyond yourself for truth. Do not seek outside yourself to quell your anxiety. Do not try to look beyond yourself for truth. Look for truth. Look for truth, but not beyond yourself. Look for truth. Look for truth. Look for truth inside yourself, within yourself, inside yourself, within yourself. Don't seek. Don't try to look outside yourself, beyond yourself, for truth. When you feel anxious, when you feel depressed, and when you feel panic, just say, Christ is in me, and where He is, God must be. Christ is in me, and where Christ is, God must be. Don't try to look beyond yourself for truth. Look within for truth. Look within for truth. When you feel these things, look within for truth. And the way you look within for truth is you say, Christ is in me, and where Christ is, God must be. Because Christ is part of God. Christ is in me, and where Christ is, God must be, for Christ is part of God. Truth is in me, truth is in me, truth is in me. Healing is in me, truth is in me, healing is in me, truth is in me. Because truth and healing is part of God. The answer to prayer. Everyone who has ever tried to use prayer to request something has experienced what appears to be failure. This is not only true in connection with specific things which might be harmful, but also in connection with requests which are strictly in line with this course. The latter, prayers in line with this course, those in particular, might be incorrectly interpreted as proof. So-called proof that the course does not mean what it says. When I ask for things that are in alignment with this course and I don't get them, I am likely to incorrectly interpret that as proof that this course doesn't mean what it says. But you must remember, however, that the course does not state. You must remember, however, that the course does state and repeatedly states that the course's purpose is to escape from fear. Let us suppose, then, that what you request of the Holy Spirit is what you really want, to escape from fear. But you're still afraid of what you really want. You're still afraid of your will. The Course tells you that its purpose is to help you escape from fear. And let's just say you say to Holy Spirit, I am requesting the escape from fear. That's what I really want. Let's say you're requesting that, remembering that's what you really want, but you're still afraid of it. If that is the case, then your attainment of the escape from fear really is no longer what you really want, even if it really is. This accounts for why certain specific forms of healing are not achieved, even though the state of healing is. Why is it that certain specific forms of healing are not achieved, even though the state of healing is, even though we're praying for it or asking for it. Why is it that certain specific forms of healing are not achieved even when I'm asking for it or praying for it? I'm asking for what I really want, which is the escape from fear, but I'm still afraid of what I want. I'm still afraid of being released from fear. And so now, being released from fear is no longer what I want, even though it is really. And that's why sometimes when I ask for escape from fear, I seem not to get it, even though I asked for it. It frequently happens that an individual asks for physical healing because he is fearful of bodily harm. But at the same time, however, if he were healed physically, the threat to his thought system would be considerably more fearful to him than its physical expression. In this case, that person is not really asking for release from fear, that person is just praying for the removal of a symptom, which that person themselves selected. When somebody is praying and asking for the release from the removal of a symptom, then that they themselves selected, this request is not for healing at all, and that's why sometimes prayer seems not to be answered. The Bible emphasizes that all prayers are answered, and this must be true if no effort is wasted. It must be true that all prayers are answered. It must be true if no effort is wasted. The very fact that one has asked the higher mind for anything will ensure a response. Yet it is equally certain that no response given by the higher mind will ever be one which would increase fear. It's possible that the higher mind's answer will not be heard at all, but it's impossible, however, that the higher mind's answer will be lost. There are many answers which you have already received but have not yet heard. I assure you that these answers are waiting for you. It is indeed true that no effort is wasted. No effort is wasted when you are asking something of the higher mind. No effort is ever wasted when you are making a request or a prayer to the higher mind. You may not hear its answer, but it's impossible that the higher mind not answer you when you call to it. If you would know that your prayers are answered, never doubt a soul of God. To never doubt a soul of God means don't question that soul. Don't confound that soul, because your faith in that soul is your faith in yourself. If you would know your prayers are answered, never doubt another. Don't question that soul. Don't confound that soul, because your faith in that soul in front of you is your faith in yourself. And so if you would know God and God's answer for you, believe in me, whose faith in you cannot be shaken. Can you ask of the higher mind truly and still doubt your brothers and sisters? Can you ask the higher mind authentically? Can you ask the higher mind truly and still doubt everybody else? Believe that the higher minds believe that your brothers and sisters' words are true because of the truth which is in them. Believe their words are true because the truth is in them. You will unite with the truth in them, and then their words will be true. you will unite with the truth in them, and then their words will be true. You will unite with the truth in them, and their words will be true. As you hear them, you will hear me, says the voice of the Course. Listening to truth in them and in our teacher, that is the only way you can hear truth now and finally know truth. The only way to hear truth and to know truth is to listen to truth in your brother and in your teacher. Listening to truth is the only way you can hear truth now and finally know truth. How do I come to know truth? By listening to truth. How do I do that? By listening to the truth in each other, because the truth is in them. And thereby enabling ourselves to listen to the truth of our teacher. So the message that others give you is up to you. What do they say to you? What do others say to you? What would you have others say to you? Your decision about them determines the message you receive from them. Remember that the higher mind is in them. And remember that the higher mind's voice speaks to you through them. And then what can so holy a brother tell you except truth? I remember that the higher mind is in them, and that the higher mind speaks to me through them. And then what could someone, some friend so holy, say to me except the truth? I acknowledge the truth in them. What are they going to say to me except the truth? I acknowledge love in them. What are they going to speak to me and acknowledge to me? Love, the truth. What can so holy a person tell you about yourself except truth? But are you listening to it? This person may not know who they are, but there is a light in this person's mind which does know what they are. And this light in their mind which does know who they are, this light in them can shine into your mind, making their words true and making you able to hear them. This person's words are the Holy Spirit's answer to you. But is your faith in this person strong enough to let you hear God's answer to you through them? Is your faith in them strong enough to let you hear truth's words? Freedom and healing is of your brother. Healing and freedom is of your brother and your sister. Healing is of others. The higher mind extends from your mind to their mind and answers you. The Holy Spirit extends from your mind to their mind and answers you. The higher mind extends from your mind to their mind, which answers you. In other words, you cannot hear the voice for God in yourself alone, because you are not alone. And God's answer is only for what you are, which is not alone. You will not know the trust I have in you unless you extend that trust to others. You will not know the trust I have in you until you extend that trust to others. You will not trust the guidance of the higher mind or believe that that guidance is for you unless you hear that guidance from the higher mind in others. The guidance from the higher mind must be for your brother, because that guidance from higher mind is for you, because it is for you. In other words, would God have created a voice for just you alone? And could you hear God's answer except as God answers all of God's souls? So hear of others what you would have me hear of you. Hear of them what you would have me hear of you. For you wouldn't want me to be deceived. Hear of them what you would have me hear of you. For you would not want me to be deceived. I love you for the truth in you, just like God does. Your deceptions may deceive you, but your deceptions cannot deceive me, says the voice of the Course. Knowing what you are, I cannot doubt you. I hear only the higher mind in you. I hear only the higher mind in you who speaks to me through you. The higher mind in you speaks to me through you. If you would hear me, says the teacher of the Course, then hear my brothers and sisters in whom God's voice speaks. If you would hear me, hear my brothers in whom God's voice speaks. If you would hear me, hear my brothers in whom God's voice speaks. Hear them, because the answer to all prayers lies in them, your brothers and sisters. You will be answered as you hear the answer in everyone. Don't listen to anything else besides the answer that is in everyone. Don't listen to anything else in them. Don't listen to anything else in them. Listen for the voice for God in them, because the voice for God is in them. And if you will listen only to the voice for God in them, then you will hear God's answer to you. Believe in them, because I believe in you. Believe in them because I believe in you. And then you will learn that my belief in you is justified. Believe in them because I believe in you. Pay it forward. Believe in them because I believe in you. And once you do that, you will learn that my belief in you is justified. My belief in you is justified because I believe in them. Believe in me by believing in them, says the voice of the Course. Believe in them for the sake of what God gave them. And if you learn to ask only this truth of them, and see only this truth in them, and listen to this only this truth in them, then they will answer you. Don't ask for blessings from them without blessing them first. For only in blessing them can you learn how blessed you are. By following this way, blessing others so that you can know how much you are blessed, by following this way, you are looking for the truth in you. That's how you look for the truth in you. Look for the truth in them, so that you can hear the truth about yourself. This is the way you follow the truth in you. This is a way that you follow the blessed way, believing in them, because love believes in me. Learning how blessed I am by blessing others. This is not going beyond myself, but toward myself. And so hear only God's answer in God's souls. And if you hear only God's answer in everyone, then you are answered. To disbelieve somebody is to side against or to attack them. To believe is to accept and to side with. So what does it mean to believe in the truth in our brothers? It means to accept and to side with, not to be credulous, but just to accept and appreciate. What you do not believe, you do not appreciate, and you cannot be grateful for what you do not value. There is a price you will pay for judgment, because judgment is the setting of a price. And as you set that price, you will pay it. There is a price you will pay for judgment, because judgment is the setting of a price. And as you set that price, you will pay it. The price of judgment. If paying is equated with getting, then you will set the price low, but demand a high return. You will have forgotten, however, that your return is in exact proportion to what you gave for it, your judgment of its worth. And so if paying is associated with giving, then that paying cannot be perceived as loss, and the reciprocal relationship of giving and receiving will be recognized. You'll see that when you gave, you didn't lose, you gained. The price, once you associate paying with giving, once you make that association, the price will then be set high because of the value of the return. The price for getting is to lose sight of value, making it inevitable that what you get, you won't want. The price for getting is to lose sight of value, making it inevitable that you won't value whatever you get. Valuing what you get too little, you won't appreciate it, and so you won't even want the little that you got. Never forget then that you set the value on what you receive, and you have priced what you receive by what you give. To believe that it's possible to get much for little is to believe that you can bargain with God. But God's laws are always fair, and God's laws are always perfectly consistent, which means by giving, you receive. God's laws are always fair and perfectly consistent. By giving, you receive. But to receive is to accept and not to get. To receive is to accept and not to get. It's impossible not to have, but it's impossible not to know you have. The recognition of having is the willingness for giving. The recognition of having is the willingness for giving. It's impossible not to have, but it is possible not to know you have. And so the recognition of having is the willingness for giving. And only this willingness for giving can you recognize what you have. Only by this willingness for giving can you recognize what you have. What you give is therefore the value you put on what you have, being the exact measure of the value you put upon it. And this in turn is the measure of how much you want it. You can ask of the higher mind then only by giving to the higher mind. And you can give to the higher mind only where you see the higher mind. And so if you see the higher mind in everyone, consider how much you will be asking of the higher mind and how much you will receive of the higher mind. See the higher mind in everyone. See the higher mind in everyone, because it's only there that you can ask of the Holy Spirit anything. You can ask of the Holy Spirit then only by giving to the higher mind. And you can give to the higher mind only where you see the higher mind. And so if you see the higher mind in everyone, consider how much you will be asking of the higher mind. And how much you will receive. You can only ask of the higher mind where you see the higher mind. And so if you see the higher mind in everyone, then see how much you are asking of the higher mind and receiving also. The higher mind will deny you nothing because you have denied the higher mind nothing. And so now you can share everything. This is the way, this is the only way to have the higher mind's answer, because the higher mind's answer is all you can really ask for and want. So say then to everyone, because I will to know myself, I see you as God's child and my brother. Because I will to know myself, I see you as love's creation. Sibling, my brother, my sister, because I will to know myself, I see you as God's child and my brother and sister.